you started doing music videos.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. Yeah,
for Channel U.
Yeah.
Could you have bought that outright, 4 million?
Yeah. I've now generated about £1 million just for Bants.
Oh, just £1 million.
No.
Light work.
No, straight face for Bants. Like, I'd bought like the first Essex Country Manor and then bought a Lambo a couple of weeks later, Bentley or whatever order it was, I don't know. You don't become rich by owning your house outright. Mm-hmm. You become rich by owning 10 houses.
100%. So welcome, Antoine.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming.
Pleasure.
I mean, what do I call you? Do I call you a squire now?
Do you know what? my friends have made that joke. I don't know. Technically, I'm a country squire, but yeah. I'm still a city boy, so a bit of both.
And the reason why I ask that is because you've recently bought a country Georgian mansion, so mm-hmm. to speak, mm-hmm. for 4 million, mm-hmm. Situated in land around, is it 50 acres?
52
acres. And to put things into perspective, a professional football pitch is 2 acres.
Yeah.
So it's got its own lake.
Yeah.
It's huge, it's vast.
Yeah.
Well, why did you buy that?
I'm kind of residing in the countryside already.
Okay.
So I had my eye on certain areas, but I wasn't too sure about the reason why I wanted to purchase it in the first place, whether it would be for hospitality. Mm-hmm. I was dabbling with a hotel, but film is where I come from. That's my background. Mm-hmm. And I had a dream of potentially one day opening a movie studio, kind of like a film village, you know, like a Pinewood or mm-hmm. or what have you. So with like big back lots and stuff. So I saw an opportunity and grabbed it, basically. It was on the cheap. Mm-hmm. I call it Black Friday, what I got that place for. And I'm really looking forward to what's to come now.
So what was the asking price?
It was around that, but the place was really, really run down. Like,
okay.
Tremendously run down. Mm-hmm. There's 14 outbuildings that all need work. The main mansion has lots of room to develop, plus it's tired in lots of areas, and it reflected that in the valuation. So it was an opportunity that if I do the right things, a lot's going to come from that, just from a property side, let alone the business aspect of it. So
wow. And how did you take out a mortgage? I wouldn't even know how you would purchase a property for business purposes of that magnitude.
Yeah, it's like traditionally, you know, part mortgage, part deposit, you know.
Okay, well, if you don't mind me asking, what is the deposit on something like a 4 million pound
you'd put
house?
You'd put maybe 1.5 million, just under 2 mil.
And you'd
mortgage the rest, basically. Obviously, mortgaging is also another thing that you need to overcome, because you need the power, financial power, to be able to get those mortgages.
Yeah. And before we go back, how you even got to this point, what would you say to people that say, do you know what, don't have a mortgage, don't take out a loan, if you've got the cash, like, if you could, or could you have bought that outright, 4 million?
Yeah.
Why didn't you?
It doesn't make sense.
It doesn't?
No, leveraging is power, basically. Okay. So it doesn't make sense to have that unencumbered. You want to spread your money and create more wealth.
And I think that's something that I grew up hearing that all the time. Yeah. And you would get mocked if you got anything on credit, if you took out any loans. Even now when people say, I've got a mortgage, it's not even yours though. You don't even own it. Like, why do you think that people have that misconception that taking out a loan or a mortgage is a negative thing?
It's old school approach. I mean, my mum, Caribbean lady, come from the position of, you know, go to school, get good grades, go to university, get a great job, buy your house, own your house, repayment mortgage only. Traditional, that's the old school thinking. But depending on what you want to aspire towards, that could be good or could be bad. It all depends on what you want. There's nothing wrong that you can't say it's bad to own your house. If you can even buy your house, that's great. If you can own it outright, good for you. But it depends what you want. But if your money is situated in one place, then how could you use the capital to go and create more wealth?
So you
it's
think
sitting
even
in
if,
one area.
Yeah, so even if you have savings, mm-hmm. you think you should keep those savings. And if you can get a loan or a mortgage, you should always utilise that.
Yeah, because then you can use your money more than once.
Mm.
You know, if you buy, okay, typical example, you got £1 million and you want to buy a house that costs £1 million.
Mm-hmm.
Some people just say, go and buy it outright, or my goal is to own that outright. Okay, cool. So you've got that £1 million,
mm-hmm.
and you go and place that in the actual asset. So your £1 million is moved from there to there.
Mm-hmm.
capital growth, as we know, is when property increases in value over time. So if you get a 10% increase in capital growth over, say, 5 years, which is 2% a year, mm-hmm. you get a growth of £100,000 in equity, in capital growth, right? So you are now worth 100 grand more. If you took, you got a 25% deposit on loan on a buy-to-let, mm-hmm. so you put £250,000 down per house, it gives you four properties, right? Mm-hmm. To spread the £1 million out. Now, if you get capital growth across the board now on four properties, you now have a multiple of four.
Yep.
So that £100,000 is now multiplied four times because you've spread that £1 million across four properties. You now have a £400,000 growth as opposed to £100,000.
So more passive income. No-brainer.
Well, passive income is the next positive. I just did a piece in The Express about this, basically, mm-hmm. which is a couple of weeks ago. Passive income is another great thing because you get passive income off the one property, but then you multiply it by four. You get the capital growth of one property, but now you multiply that by four. So everything is multiplied. That's how you build wealth. So leveraging mm-hmm. and being able to spread that across enables you to grow, basically.
And we're not encouraging people to just go out and get frivolous loans. It's about if you can manage the money, it makes sense.
Well, there's good debt and there's bad debt, isn't there?
Yeah. What would you say is a good debt and what's a bad debt?
Good debt is anything that can make you money. If you borrow money, well, that's what leveraging is. If you borrow money to be able to spend it on being a cash flow and asset or giving a return or a growth, it's good debt because it's speculative. So you're mm-hmm. taking that money and it's going to make you more money. So you pay that off eventually and then you have this left. Bad debt is something that depreciates. Doesn't cash flow, you know, and like a car is a bad debt if you wanted to buy it for investment purposes. Not saying that you shouldn't buy a car on finance. What I'm saying is if you bought it for the sake of it,
Was that a disclaimer? Because a little birdie told me you got a Lambo, a Bentley. So is that your bad debt? Or did you buy it outright?
No. I bought my cars on finance.
Okay.
Because it makes perfect sense.
Why?
Because I've got more money to spend on other things that actually make me money.
Okay.
You know, so my asset depreciates, mm-hmm. but at least all my money. So it's my money, my small portion of money that I put in that depreciates, mm-hmm. but so does the rest of the money that it costs to purchase it, which wasn't my money. Mm-hmm. Do you understand what I mean?
Makes total sense.
So I limit the risk.
Yeah, I've said similar things and people are like, no, but you don't own it. But then if you have the money, you said, the capital, then you can use that capital. But this is not for people that you're broke taking out loans.
Another example for them listening or watching is if you've got money to buy a really expensive car or you could buy a flat, an investment property, why not buy the flat, use the rental income from the flat to pay for the car finance whilst your property appreciates in value?
And then you can take out the equity and do something else later.
Ta-da.
Okay, so now that we've heard a bit about that,
yeah.
let's talk about your actual assets. So, and you can chip in at any point.
Sure.
You've got a multi-million pound business making camera lenses.
Sure.
You've got film studios in East London, or is it North London?
It's called East London Studios.
In North London?
It was originally in East London.
How does this make sense?
East London Studios was born in 2014.
Okay.
And it was in Leytonstone.
Okay, fair enough.
Most of the people know it. And this was a lease. So I bought this from a landlord. Landlord decided to knock the place down and sell it to a school, compulsory purchase order. Then I was like, right, what do I do? We're talking about a 6,000 square foot space, commercial space in London is a serious commodity, right? Mm-hmm. So we were looking at places to lease. And I was like, I don't want to lease nothing. I want to buy it for two reasons. Mm-hmm. A, I don't want to get kicked out ever again. Mm-hmm. Don't like the feeling. Mm-hmm. Not about it. Mm-hmm. Secondly, being able to own the premises means that I can control the value of the actual company that's within it. Because if I try to sell the firm years down the line, mm-hmm. but I've got a two-year lease left on the property, the business is only worth the income for the next 2 years. Because mm-hmm. there's no guarantee that you can move, get a converted film studio and make it work. So being able to purchase a premises meant that I can control how long I keep the business flowing for, mm-hmm. which adds value to the eventual sale.
Okay.
Right? So an amazing property came around, which is in North London, but right on the cusp, because you're like meters away from Black Horse Road. So you're like...
It's North London, please. Right, it's Tottenham. It's North London.
Well, let's call it Tottenham Hell. but it's right on the cusp. Yes, okay. it is North London. And... But it's an amazing location, super regeneration around there, mm-hmm. and really accessible. We're really, really happy.
And that's really unusual that you have a commercial building for your film studios and you actually own it.
Yeah, yeah, for sure.
And this is to like veer off topic quickly, but I'm interested to know what you feel or think about gentrification then, because oftentimes when an area is gentrified and all the locals are moved out, it's because they don't own the premises.
Sure.
So do you think that people's aim when they're opening up a business should be to try and own the premises?
Not always.
Okay.
No, not always. For my particular strategy, it made sense because as a film studio, mm-hmm. you sell space, right? It's a big empty film stage. So that makes sense. Not every business should be that. If it can cash flow itself and it can service its debt, and you want to be nimble and potentially move, or mm-hmm. depending on your business model, it isn't always best to buy.
Okay, so you've got film studios, you've got multi-million pound camera lens company, yeah. portfolios worth 15 million,
yeah.
and you're still quite young in your 30s. So yeah, how have you managed?
Well, there's a camera and lighting rental company
okay.
called Cine House, mm-hmm. which services most of the film production in the country. There is a production company, which most people still associate me as a producer. Okay. Well, I'm an executive producer now, but that's where I've come from. That's been my flagship, what started me off, what brought me here today, my production company. And we predominantly produce like high-end music videos, some TV commercials.
Okay, and is that what you started doing, music videos?
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. Yeah,
for Channel U?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. So what got you into that?
I had a business partner at the time who's now a really cool Afrobeat director.
Okay.
And has been killing it for years. And we started a company called Mastermind Productions in 2002.
Oh, wow.
Basically, so we're talking almost 20 years.
Mm-hmm.
And we met at uni, he's got his degree, I've got mine. We merged. We decided to be, you know, self-shooter, self-editor. And we found out about this company, this channel called Channel U. It was like, do you know there's a music video channel that they take these like amateur videos and they put them on TV and you're on television? And he was like, you're lying. We found it on the EPG, right? Mm-hmm. On the Sky. And we started seeing these videos and it gave us ideas that inspired us because we saw the platform and said, right, let's get some artists together and let's try and do our thing.
Mm-hmm.
And the rest is just history, to be honest, you know.
And then, so around that time, you were about, what, 21?
Yeah, ish.
Ish?
Yeah, around that. Yeah, I was around that age. And maybe 20, 21. And yeah, I was just aspiring. Like, I started this before I went to university, well, on the cusp of university. And it ended up hiring university peers and people in my class to come and do work experience and work on jobs and giving them opportunities at the same time while I was building my own career and they were building theirs. Mm. We were still trying to get our degree. You know?
Where did you grow up?
Southeast London.
Whereabouts?
Greenwich.
Okay, yeah. So not far?
Yeah, not far. I'm a South boy.
Okay.
Although I am associated to other areas, but I maintain myself.
What do you mean by you're associated to other areas?
Lived in North London for years. Okay. Now I live in the countryside, but I'm from Southeast London.
You're from Southeast London?
That's it. Born and bred South.
And what did you study at uni for undergrad?
Undergrad digital broadcast media, which is quite vast. It's like radio, yeah. television. In my master's, I did digital film and animation. So that was strictly post-production.
Mm.
I've quite well versed in post.
Okay. And then what, because you said your Caribbean background, right? Mm. What made you want to study that at university? And when you told, because you said you come from a single parent home.
Yes.
And how did your mum take that? Was she like, this is foolishness, why do you want to study this? Or was she supportive?
Typical Caribbean, I guess typical, even African as well. She's like, you're going to be a doctor or a lawyer? I'm like, thumbs up. But I've got an interesting story. I was supposed to be a footballer.
Okay.
I've, like most people. But,
like most, right?
Yeah, but I played for academies since young, mm-hmm. Millwall, then Wimbledon, then played for Arsenal youth team.
Mm-hmm.
I was in the same Arsenal youth team as Ashley Cole, Jay Boothroyd. Anyway, so I played a serious high level mm-hmm. and thought I was going to make it because I was signed from the age of 11. I didn't see anything else other than that.
Mm-hmm.
All of a sudden got released. Too much of a snob to go and play for a lower side, which I regretted years later. Mm-hmm. And, you know, had to take some time out and just figure out what I was going to do, basically. And I took a year and a half out, wasn't too sure, then started taking an interest in film. I thought it was just the next coolest thing because from the outside looking in, it looks like glitz and glam. As you know, when you get inside the industry, it's hard work.
Usually, though, I'd say if it's not football, it's usually like a rapper or an actor. I feel, I always say this, but within our community, we love to be at the front. We like to be seen. So how come you decided that you wanted to be a part of film production as opposed to being on the stage in front of the mic?
I'm a behind the scenes type of person, or I'd like to think I am. I'm not so cool about being in front of camera too much. And business is built from the back. And I always wanted to be entrepreneurial. I mean, I used to be a director for years and years and years and years. And realize, and again, shout out to all the creatives out there, because without the arts, you know, this wouldn't be here. So I realized that I wasn't as passionate about the art as I was about the business. So I stopped directing because I didn't think I was doing the industry a justice, because I wasn't as passionate as the next guy that really wanted the opportunities.
As in, you weren't as driven with regards to your creativity. You're more of a business mind.
Yeah, I found it hard to recreate my creativity on every job. And I was like, I'm not really enjoying this. And I'm feeling the pressure.
And that's unusual.
Yeah, but that's because I realized it wasn't for me. And it's about it's about making that self-awareness and be like, maybe sidestep. And I've always been aspirational. I've been visualizing the best since I was a child. And stepping away from being a director and being creative and being more business was an opportunity for me to fulfill my dream, basically. So then thought, how can I build this company? How can I make more money? Then camera equipment was purchased and it built and built and built and built. I didn't actually have an exact plan of how it was going to go. Obviously, instincts meet opportunity. I was able to kind of work out where and how I could build assets in order to get to build one company, then sidestep to another.
Okay, so if we do like a timeline, so you went to university.
Yes.
You did your undergrad. And while you were doing your undergrad, did you have like a part-time job or?
Mastermind, I was shooting low budget music videos.
Oh, you was already doing Channel U while you were at uni?
Absolutely, yeah. Okay. But again, few and far between jobs. I wasn't kind of like mobbed with videos at that time. It might have been like a couple of months, basically. Then I realized that I wanted more money and wasn't making enough money. So when I finished university, I went and got a full-time job and I worked as an editor, which is something that really inspired me, which is quite an interesting story. I worked as a post-production editor for quite a big post-production company in Covent Garden, got the job because I'm skilled in motion graphics, etc. Was on, again, really modest salary of...
What was that?
14,000 a year entry, and I'm working in central London. I'm living in southeast London. I'm paying my rent. I have to get to work, which is an hour and a half there, hour and a half back. Basically, after my tax and then all my expenses, I was left with about £200 a month.
Yeah, that's mad, because when a lot of people go and apply for a job, especially now, they will see 14,000 a year and they will say, excuse my French, fuck that.
Yeah, of course.
Like, I'm not working for 14,000.
Yeah, yeah.
So how did you, like a young black guy, Southeast London, say, do you know what? I'm going to see the bigger picture. Doesn't matter if it's like 14,000.
I think regarding the film industry, a lot of people know that it's very hard, or media in general, to leave university and get a job. Very, very difficult. Most people are doing work experience for years before they can even get proper opportunities. So I was grateful to get in, and I was working with clients like blue chip clients, and they were sitting in on my edits, like with Accenture, Thomas Cook, BT, Suzuki. And I was just happy to be in the mix in real life.
See the experience.
I thought it was a means to an end as well. I thought I was going to, I had this idea that this guy, you know, the company were going to just love me and value me and keep increasing my salary. So I did a year and I've sat down with the owner and I've said, look, it's been a year, I've done really well, I think you agree. And he's like, yeah, you've made us lots of money this year. Have you enjoyed it? He goes, yeah. I said, so, but obviously, you know, I live really, really far and I think I deserve a pay rise and I'd like to discuss that. He goes, yeah, of course. And I was like, okay, what would you suggest? And he went, Antoine, you've worked really hard this year, really satisfied our clients, a lot of them respect and ask for you. And I'm going to change your salary from 14,000 a year and increase it to 15,000 a year. swear, as God's watching,
he just took the piss, basically.
It's a true story. I looked at him. I went, okay. I walked out the room, left the building, and never came back.
That was it.
That was
the
moment.
Didn't even give notice.
No, I was, mate, no way. I was done. I was like, I felt so disrespected.
Yeah.
And it was just a mock, giant mock. But you need these L's to help you with the future W's. Because I was like, this is what I needed to sit there and go, I need some ownership, right? I need to aspire. How can I have my own clients? Not how can I take advantage of people, but how can I create my own wealth on my own terms? Are you with me? And reduce those variables. And that's when I really started going hard back into Mastermind Media and trying to get more and more jobs. And then things kind of blew and did really well from there on that side of things, you know?
So you did your undergraduate.
Yeah.
You left the disrespectful job that only tried to increase your salary by 1K.
Yeah.
And then you went to go and do your master's.
Yes. So I got a freelance job that I was working a few days a week, which ended up almost being full-time because I was in demand for this job. And again, this was really, really far. But then thought to myself, I wanted to get a master's. And I didn't want to get a master's for any particular reason other than I thought it would be cool to have MA. And literally, as shallow as it is, I was like, let me just try it and do it, which almost backfired on me because I underestimated the work.
The workload.
I flew through my undergraduate, did really well, didn't even probably put in 100%. Again, not to say that you should do that, always put in 100%. Mm. I was lucky enough to do really, really well. And I thought, master's, yeah, same old thing, easy. No. I think it's the first time ever in my life that I hadn't slept for 3 days for natural reasons.
Gosh.
Like, I was working, I had assignments were just ridiculous, dissertation, it was mental. And it was probably the most painful experience I've ever had was trying to do both. And I didn't want to give up. I couldn't afford to stop working because I had to fund my own master's, which again, naive me thought that you'd get a student loan. Nope. And almost got kicked off the course because I had to hustle my £6,000, which is what it was at the time, for my master's. Thank God I was still shooting music videos because I got some clients, got some advanced payments, paid it all to the university. And that's how I got back onto the course. So again, it's just being trying to driven, you know, but it was hard work.
But I'm sure you wouldn't regret it though, would you?
No. It's character building.
Yeah.
You know,
because when I heard that that's what I had to do the same thing.
Yes.
And it's hard.
Yes.
Literally having to study and have a full-time job.
Real hard. But here we are.
And then after you finished your master's, when did you start seeing real money? Because that's when you started to decide that you want to be the complete chain of film production. So oftentimes correct me if I'm wrong, you would outsource a lot of the things. You would purchase the cameras and all the equipment, or you would hire the studios, or and you decided to yourself, I want to own everything at each specific point.
Yeah, because after a while you do the maths. Now, I was fortunate enough that I was doing a lot of volume for production, which meant that I'm keep on spending these lines repetitively. Mm-hmm. Crew are humans. There's nothing you can do about it, you know. But equipment.
You want to replace them with robots?
Maybe one day. Who knows? You know, camera and lighting is something that you need on every single job. You cannot film without a camera and you can't light without lights unless you're outdoors. So I was looking constantly at, I'm spending this a month. I'm like, what do I need to do to own this? Now, obviously, that's when I started getting in from all those old school cameras to the, you know, progressive scan, 35mm cameras, and you started getting the Reds. And Red One was the first big boy camera that hit the film industry. The Red One was just unbelievable.
How much was it?
A full modular Red One would have been about probably 50 grand, 50, 60 grand. That doesn't include your lenses and your matte box and your follow focus and all your other bits and bobs. We're just talking about the camera body and its accessories, right? So I was like, okay, cool. So I was buying bit by bit. So like little old me would buy a camera body, rent the accessories from a hire company, then rent the lenses. And after a couple more months, buy those accessories. Now I've only got to rent the lenses. I didn't make any money from production for years. Like, people don't know this. I wasn't having it off. Lucky for me, I was still working. And that was enabling my lifestyle to like live and eat, right? So all the money I made from production, I just bought assets. I just knew that's the only way to do it. Because I kept on fantasizing about the day that I don't have to pay out for this camera, for example. So that was the mindset, and that mindset never ever changed. It was something that stuck with me in terms of how to generate cash flow and assets, you know, and retain profit, obviously, because now I'm making more than the markup.
Yeah.
And then when I eventually bought the camera, I'm then renting it out to other filmmakers. So not only am I saving money on the...
You're making money as
well. I'm making money now. You know, well, I'm making money the moment I'm not having to spend the money, but now I'm doubling up because now this director, that director. I mean, you know, before I knew it, I'm doing grands a month on just camera equipment. And I'm like, rah. So then the rest is straightforward. Now I need to add. I need lenses. I need lights. And then, you know, here we are.
It sounds good, right? But I feel like we're missing gaps somewhere thereabouts. Yeah. So we went from paying for your master's, hustling, you know, still having a full-time job to pay for a master's, which was at the time $6,000. So how did you go from there to now being able to afford a camera that's essentially without all of the mod cons and the accessories, 50 bags?
No. So that took me about 4 years, 3-4 years to get to that stage. But buying the actual body itself was like 20-odd grand. So if you're shooting like 30 music videos. By this time, I'm shooting like 3 videos a week. And if you're making £1,000 per video, or £800, whatever it is you're making at the time, that adds up very quickly. Remember, I don't touch a penny of it. That money's coming in, it's stacking. And I'm buying the first thing. Then it means, and then once I've bought the first asset, it's being cash flowed by all of the other production money that's coming in. So I'm not actually using my own money because the money that I've allocated for camera goes, that line goes back to me. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So it was paying for itself. Had production stopped, then I've got a problem because the money I'm using that I'm working for pays my lifestyle just to live, and I've got no way to purchase the assets. So then it started paying for itself.
Okay.
Are you with me?
Yeah, 100%.
And because I'm not spending that money, I can build and build and build and build.
And you didn't do any markups in terms of the pricing of your videos, did you? So you kept it low to be able to compete in the market.
And just so I could purchase equipment. Because I was like, how many ways can I spin these plates? You know, I need to be in facilities. So I saw it early. But everyone must have seen it. Because all producers are spending the same money I'm spending. We're hiring the same cameras from the same rental houses. I don't know what it was that, I don't know.
Balls, yeah, don't but know. I'm going to be honest. Again, like I said, you're still in your 30s. I'm not going to name names, but I do know of some, you know, people that are in your industry. And I don't hear of people that have a property portfolio that's worth 15 million and able to buy the premises and able to buy...
But that wasn't from that wasn't from production, though. If that was the case, we'd all be rich.
Okay, so where is the bulk of your money coming from?
Lens manufacturing. So when Cinescope Optics was born, that's my lens manufacturing company. That was, to answer your question, when I started seeing real money.
Okay.
Money.
And how? And it's so niche, isn't it?
Like tremendously niche.
Again, another thing in our community is, what are you going to do? I'm going to open up a car rental because my man's doing it and my man's doing it. And we literally just look at what someone's doing. Yeah. And then we have loads of t-shirt brands and loads of car rental companies. Sure. How did you manage to think outside the box and say, okay, the world needs specialist lenses and I'm going to make millions from that?
Yeah, I'll explain. It boils down to, again, how do I retain the lines in my budget? Remember what I said that I'm trying to acquire equipment bit by bit, right? So lenses, which is probably that's the hero product in film production, the lenses, because they appreciate, they're worth crazy money and, you know, real amazing stuff. So I wanted to buy lenses. That was the most important part that I didn't own. So there's a thing called rehoused lenses. This is real techie and only the film people watching.
Break it down for me, break it down. I don't know anything about lenses.
So you've got different cinema lens manufacturers like Zeiss and Cook and Arri and whatnot. And rehoused lenses are when you take old stills lenses and you have it rehoused or remanufactured into movie lenses. Okay, so you take, so stills are photography lenses that are still 35 mil. So that means that the way that it frames, it can still capture the full image and it's rehoused into modern day cinema lenses. This was a thing that a lot of DOPs and cinematographers would use.
DOP, sorry.
Director of photography.
Thank you very much.
Sorry. So this is a thing. And at the time, we're talking now 2013, right?
Yeah.
Now let's fast forward to 2013. There was a lens called, again, for all my geeks out there, called a Cook Pancro.
Yeah.
The Cook Pancro was an old stills lens, vintage lens.
Yeah.
Started from like 70s, 80s, 90s, even I think some of the 60s, and had just an amazing image. It was really silky smooth. And it was didn't cost hardly anything to buy. You could find them on eBay anywhere, like £500-600 a lens.
Mm-hmm.
You could take that lens, get it remanufactured from a reputable rehouser, where there was only a few at the time, and sell that particular lens for £5,000-6,000. But then you have a set of lenses. Mm-hmm. So a set of lenses could be worth 50K. Long story short, I thought this is the cheapest way for me to acquire my own set of lenses. So I went and scoured the internet and bought focal lengths, 18, 25, mm-hmm. 35, 32, sorry, whatever, all the way up to 100 mil, 100 millimeter lens. And there was a company called True Lens Services, who still to this day are the biggest, most reputable rehousing company on planet Earth, right? There's probably 6 or 7 reputable companies. They were, if not are, still number one.
Mm-hmm.
I contacted them, got my own set rehoused, right? Cost me about £2,000 a lens at the time,
mm-hmm.
to rehouse. Cost me about £12,000-14,000 plus VAT to manufacture those lenses. So maybe I'm 20 grand all in, right? Mm-hmm. Those lenses would be resold. Anyway, first of all, everyone's like, oh my God, your lenses are amazing. Can I buy them? This is like rental house people that I know, cinematographers that are further down the line. I was offered like 42, 45, 48 grand for the
and
lenses.
And you thought, hang on a minute.
That's double bubble, right?
Yeah.
And I'm like, oh.
The markup's crazy.
I'm like, snap. What if I have 3 sets, 4 sets, 5 sets? 20 sets later, right? Took me about 5 years to get 20 sets. I've now generated about £1 million just for Bantz.
Oh, just £1 million.
No.
Light work.
No, straight face for Bantz, right? Because I'm still shooting.
Yeah.
This is
so
just...
So how... You managed to buy the first initial lenses, which was £20,000
which
in,
was supposed to be for me.
For
to
you.
Use.
This wasn't with you thinking, no. I'm going
to
make money.
This is to...
You needed it to continue shooting.
My asset purchasing trajectory. That was what it was about. But then someone offered me £45,000.
Because they really liked the look of...
Yeah, but they're renowned lenses. But now it's like... But also with this company, there was a 2-year waiting list. So I was putting in orders in 2013. And when they were coming, people don't want to wait to put in their... Because people could have bought their own glass. And then take it to get manufactured. Mm-hmm. But no one's got 2 years.
Mm.
So they're like, I'll buy it now. So I then put in a back order of like 5-6 at once and got them. And it was like hotcakes, right?
It's because like there was not many places that you could get them from. So you found your niche.
Found my niche. And,
okay.
And that's how I got into that side of the industry. And as I said, about £1 million later, I was like, oh, I wonder if I should take this seriously now.
Because that's where... the substantial amount of money that you make is from.
Right.
Because how you managed to get the 20,000 to even buy the first set of lenses was through shooting videos.
Exactly.
But then you stumbled on this.
Then I used all the money from the lens manufacturing company, mm-hmm. to buy more camera assets.
Yeah.
To now complete my camera set.
Yeah.
And I used that money to cash flow that. So now I'm still saving more money on production. I'm now still making more money from renting to industry peers.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm still making more money now, in abundance of the lenses that I'm rehousing, I'm being able to cash flow those the manufacturing of that, because you still have to spend £25,000 to get your set made.
Mm-hmm.
That's not light, right? And then I'm now flipping these lenses.
So you're basically the plug for all film things.
Yeah,
cameras.
Yeah. I mean,
studio.
I became, I think, by 2015, I was True Lenses' best customer on earth, basically. And I'd go to trade shows around the world and they would introduce me as that. And people would look at me like, it's fucking like this young black boy, like, huh? Like, we're not getting it. But it is what it is, and it was what it was. So I'd use that money, then I bought my first proper house with money from selling those lenses. So then again, I'm flipping assets into assets.
And what are we talking in terms of, on average a month, how much are you making now from flipping these lenses?
Well, I'd only probably sell a set a month,
okay.
To be honest.
And how much was that, £20,000?
25.
So
but then I've still got production money, which isn't much to write home about.
So where are we now in terms of age-wise? Are we around 30 now or 29?
Yeah, 29, 30, 31,
yeah.
32.
Okay, so let's say for argument's sake, between 29 and 31,
yeah.
And you're making on average, including the money that you're making from production, mm-hmm. are we saying like 35,000 a month?
Ish. Yeah, ish. But to me, it's nil-nil. So what I mean, that's my saying. So if you're in football, when you're winning a match, right, mm-hmm. and you're winning 2-3, 4-0, mm-hmm. you go back to the kickoff spot and your manager goes, and your boys go, right, still nil-nil, which means have that mindset that you're not winning.
Okay.
It's still nil-nil, mm-hmm. right? And that was something that I've, an ethos I've took with me, and that is part of my secret. It's always nil-nil. Right now it's nil-nil.
And that's something that I found really interesting that people don't really want to hear or grasp right mm-hmm. now, is that you took a job that was only paying 15K.
Sure.
Even after that, you still could have done well without going to do a master's, but you wanted that kudos of having a master's.
Absolutely.
And then, even then, you were making money, but you pushed all the money back into your business. That's and the problem is now, I think people are so desperate to look lit, so desperate to look flashy, that they spend off their profit.
This is the
when
thing.
They should be pushing it back into the business.
This is the thing. When it became a bit uncomfortable when people started to realise I was wealthy, because like I'd bought like the first Essex Country Manor and then bought a Lambo a couple weeks later, Bentley or whatever order it was, I don't know. And then everyone was like, "Ant, have you won the lottery? Like low key." I'm like, "No, I could have done this years ago." Like what? But you was living modest in a 3-bedroom terraced house. I'm like, albeit you owned it, but you was modest. You've jumped about 7 houses in scale. I'm like, I could have done this years ago, but I'm busy buying assets that are going to pay for everything that I have right now. To me, it's 4 days.
And you
normal.
Probably wouldn't even be as wealthy if you just spent off your money. As soon as you saw a little bit of money coming in from the lenses, yeah. like... cars, holidays, girls,
never bottles. Never interested. Not to say I don't like nice things.
Yeah.
I like nice things. But I understood the quickest way to do it was to...
Nil-nil.
And it's all about asset generation. It's as simple as that. It really is straightforward. Honestly, I did well. Okay, I did okay at school, right? Mm. I'm not a genius. To me, this is so straightforward.
And like, what about in terms of like your... So you didn't have your father around?
Yes, correct.
Was there any reason for that or?
No, my mum and my dad weren't together. My dad was a bit of a loser, wasn't around. Mm. Mum stepped up. Mum was mum and dad, mm-hmm. whole time mumsy, and strong Dominican woman, and that's it. I was raised by women.
So no one put you on them, because that's another thing that we often hear. Mm. Like, it's easy for, let's say, the middle class people or the white man or mm-hmm. whatever, because they always are put on.
Yeah.
But no one put you on.
Absolutely not. Super hard, super hard. I never got opportunities, never got invited on set. No one opened any doors for me. And some people in the industry think that our aunt's got, is a bit hard skinned, is a bit, you know, but they just don't understand. They don't understand, you know, there's privilege, there's lack of privilege, mm-hmm. You know, inverted commas. And there's, Just uphill battles, and I've had to knock down every single door, bulldoze it, create my own opportunities, and that's why I'm really adamant now about trying to use my success as a platform for people to not have to go through what I went through, because not everybody's built that way, and that's okay. Mm. We don't all have to be savage, right? And when I say savage, I'm just talking about concrete mindset, you know, like hyper focused, because that's what I am. That I'm hyper-focused, that's me. But that's a me thing, it's a characteristic. You can read a book, right? And it says, How to Be a Millionaire. If I make 100 people read that book, are 100 people gonna be millionaires?
No.
Because their mindset's not there. They understand, but they're not built that way. But that's okay, right? Because you've got all different types of people. But if that's what you really want, then it is not so difficult to get it if that's what you decide you want. Mm-hmm. But you have to really believe it before it's happened. Mm. You have to.
Yeah, I do hear that. But again, I do think many of us still need to try and adopt. If you want that success, and again, what we're seeing a lot of now is, okay, I'm not that type of person, or I don't want to put in the work, but I expect everything.
Yeah.
And life doesn't happen like that.
No,
like this entitlement of I should just get
I'm so on the same page as you. so on the same page as you. There's people that I know that are older than me that have been singing the same hymn sheet for 25 years and they're in the same
waiting
position,
for someone to put them on.
Complaining about why they're not put on, waiting for someone to put them on, blaming everybody else. And if you fail to take accountability, you can't be responsible and able to take control of your own life and aspire and move it forward. You have to understand that. You can't blame anybody. Do you see what I mean? Mm-hmm. And when you've got people like me that have come from working class backgrounds, single parent backgrounds, ethnic minority, that nobody can say they can't do it. Mm-hmm. And I'm finding about like coming out at the moment about all this because I, you know, for obvious reasons.
What are the obvious reasons?
Like, it's not cool to be the rich guy. It's not cool to be that because that comes with its problems. It's obvious problems. You know, users, setups. There's a whole heap of bad things that can come from being that dude. So it's not so cool for me. But more importantly than that, I'm understanding more and more as I get so many DMs and emails and please mentor me. And like, there's a lot of people that I can help just by giving them belief.
Yeah.
Do you understand what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like, there's so many people that think that there's no opportunities for them. They're not good enough. The industry is beyond institutional racist, which it can be, but I just want to be a testament that yes, you can do it because I didn't just get abracadabra'd. This is real. Mm-hmm. I'm real. Mm-hmm. And people can do what I did. They can.
Yeah, it's true. So like, in terms of what your name is attached to, what have you produced or...
Yeah.
In terms of music videos, films?
So no feature films as of yet.
Yeah.
That's the next chapter. But music videos, I've probably produced for almost everybody in this country. Gosh, all the usual suspects. Mm-hmm. It's just vast, so my mind's gone. But, you know, the Stormzy's, the Dave's, the...
Okay.
Yeah, usual suspects. Like, all the top guys, everyone, basically. You know, the Stephs, everyone.
And in terms of the output and the type of videos or content that our community is putting out, how do you feel about the climate of that at the moment? Because it's interesting, when I read one of the articles about you, and there was a lot of reference about Tyler Perry.
Right.
You are coined as possibly being the next UK Tyler Perry.
Sure.
And like, Tyler Perry to me is so inspirational, but he has a lot of criticism as well. Mm-hmm. Even like Spike Lee said that his work is coonery buffoonery.
Right.
Meaning that a lot of his content is perpetuating or pushing out the negative stereotypes from the black community.
Sure.
So the angry black woman, you know, the aggressive male. And in terms of you saying you want to be able to create something amazing, do you ever look at a project and say, I'm not happy about how this can make us look? Or do you just say the money's the money, the bag's the bag?
No, not at all. It's not about money for me. Like, I do production still because it's a habit. It's something that's indoctrinated in me since I was... It's what made me where I am and gave me the opportunities to see things and build to where I got to. I do it out of love now, if that makes sense. Mm-hmm. It is not for money. Everything else I do business-wise is about money. Mm-hmm. But while I'm still in this industry, I just want to give opportunity for people, a lot of people that just can't get on set. They can't get around the right equipment, get to meet the right people. And I think the Tyler Perry comparison is more about facilities. They're comparing it to Tyler Perry Studios, and obviously I own East London Studios. I have a rental company. There's this movie village that's about to happen. I think it's more on a platform, a facility.
Will you not be involved in writing the content and?
Not as a producer. That's a director's job, or a writer if you're talking about long form stuff. Mm-hmm. But producing, I just help the vision come to life, basically in terms of the director. So I help bring his stuff on screen. Well, now as an exec producer, I support the producer to do that. So I'm just the guy now that has been in the game for such a long time. I know where all of the curveballs are. I know where the mistakes are made. And I will point and navigate production and help them to get the best production value, the client to get the most for their money, make sure that the director has his creative integrity. And I'll just be that guy now. you know, and help people come through.
And you said that it was quite difficult in terms of you approaching companies. A lot of doors were closed, so you had to create your own path, so to speak. Yeah. And I think that's a massive issue when it comes to, again, going back to what I was saying, the type and the content of film that we put out there.
Yeah.
Oftentimes, there is a lot of conversation about negative films and music that comes out of our community. But when you look at the actual money behind that, a lot of big companies like Island Records are willing to back stories that are the typical on the council estate, gang violence, so on and so forth. But when it comes to actual other types of films, it's very hard to be able to raise the capital for that. Yeah. Why do you think that is?
I think regarding answering your question about supporting certain content, I think in the defense of directors or artists that are trying to tell their story through the director, as you probably heard, and I get it, they're talking about their reality. So they're kind of like saying, I don't want to kind of disempower where I've come from, because that's where I've come from. So I think that there is, not everybody glamorizes. Some people, they're just talking about what they've been through, and this is me, and they're being true to themselves. You know, to answer that question. But yeah.
When you do music videos, do you see a lot of props and things that people may take as this is what they have, but they have to rent a lot of props?
All right, I see. Yeah, it's 90% 97% props.
So it's not really their reality, is it?
I don't know. But I suspect that that isn't the reality.
I'm not trying to give you answers. I just want people to know.
Maybe they're manifesting it. Maybe.
Oh, so maybe the props is a manifestation.
Yeah, could be.
Okay, that makes sense. You know, fake it till you make it. Are you a believer in that?
Yes and no.
Okay.
With mindset. You don't have to show that type of side. You don't have to brand yourself that way. But mindset. If you believe you're great, you can be great.
Yeah.
So that's the fake it till I make it that I would encourage, is believing in yourself and knowing that you could be amazing.
Okay. So going back to now your property portfolio, how did you manage to be able to purchase so many properties? And what type? Like, what do you do in terms of, it's so hard for people to think, I'm emotionally attached to that property, but I'm not living in it. So how do you differentiate to gain in terms of profit as opposed to residential?
Me personally, I've got quite a diverse portfolio. So I have obviously country estates. I own a couple of blocks of flats. I have standard residential property, commercial, real estate. So you have a different mindset for each different thing. With the commercial, that's just making sure that the building is fit for purpose for the business that runs itself there. For the single dwelling houses, you might want to put a bit more love and care into it and think that's a family home. Let me, you know, do the extra things that would make it attract the right people. In the blocks of flats, I just want it functioning. As long as you've got good heating, good water, there's no damp, you just don't go five star necessarily, you know?
Yeah.
So you have a different mindset for the different types of portfolio that you have. That's what I would say to answer that.
Okay, because the ex-local authorities, so the ex-council properties, they're a lot cheaper oftentimes, but they're not as attractive, but they're lettable. So you would definitely suggest for someone to purchase?
Well, yeah, because not to be a bit too full, but it can be seen as free money. You know, if you have the right to purchase your property, and if it's a flat, you know, I think it's like it was 85 grand discount, or if it's a house, it's 104 or what have you. That's serious though. Now, obviously the problem that most people will have, especially in London, people can't afford to buy. You're bought out now. 20 years ago, you're good. There's 100% mortgages, and there's, you know, the barrier to entry was a lot lower. Now, you need to have a serious job and have serious money to have your 4-to-1 or 5-to-1 multiple to be able to get your borrow, but then you've got to raise your deposit. So it's hard. So I would, if I was in that position, I would have someone live with me, we'd buy the house together, because now we can put two incomes, we can put two deposits, and you've got a lot more, well, now you've got 100% more chance of actually buying that property, rather than so many people that live in their houses, have the right to buy, but never will buy it. A, because they don't have a deposit, B, because they don't have the salary to get the mortgages, mm-hmm. and they're just going to sit there until, you know, they die.
Someone takes the tendency.
Yeah.
And basically, that's interesting that you said that, because that is the foundation as to why Indians specifically in the UK own so many property, mm-hmm. because the foundation of that is partnership and family.
Absolutely.
So you're, in short, saying, like, you know, don't shy away from this whole new narrative of I'm going to get my own, I'm not going to be with someone. Or would you encourage people to try and have a relationship and also to see that as a business?
I read a few books, but one particular book I read, again, is something that I take from my acumen in business. Mm. And the saying makes me smile every time. And it just answers your question. 1% of something is better than 100% of nothing.
Mm-hmm.
You with me?
Mm-hmm.
That answers that question. Of course, if you don't have the capability to do something by yourself at that moment, mm-hmm. you might need some help.
Mm-hmm.
And then you have a part of something rather than nothing, you know? And you can keep willing and wishing and the opportunity just goes by.
But do you think it's really hard for, especially like with young guys in today's society, because we know that, especially for men and emotions, it's hard to maintain a relationship and tap into those like softer feelings, but then to have that driven mentality which is needed for business. So there's always that like argument of, should I not settle down and build my empire alone and then find my woman, or should I try and build and find a woman first? What would you suggest in terms of...
It depends on the man, and it depends on the woman or the prospective woman, because some men, if we're talking about men as an example, might just be better focused by themselves and not get distracted and to build their themselves. Some other men might really need the support of a really amazing woman, because if you've got the right woman, she can help elevate you anyway. Because that's the person that you're going to spend the most time with, is your loved one, other than your colleague at work, right? So if that woman is pushing you and your team and you've got your plans together and she's the right woman, then she might be able to help that man to fly.
Mm-hmm.
Are you with me? So it does depend on the man and on the woman. And based on that polarity, we'll
pick the right one, basically.
Of course. Or don't.
Yeah, you know? Exactly. And another interesting thing that I heard you say was in terms of professionalism on set. And for me, these are the key rudiments of, you know, success. Everything that you've said in terms of like knowledge and education, not shying away from having a job, because you get that experience, don't you?
Yes, of course.
But also how you behave in terms of professionalism. And I think there is a debate to be had that, why should I conform on one hand?
Yeah.
Like, if I want to just be myself, talk how I want, whatever the case may be, I should be able to do that. But on the other hand is, if you're new into an environment or a business, then you should watch and conduct yourself to be able to camouflage before you have that sort of confidence of doing what the hell you like.
100%. A lot of friends or people that I know often ask me for advice, and they're like, look, I want to be successful at this, whether it be whatever, right? And I always say, infiltrate. Don't guess. Infiltrate. Go and do work experience. You think you're doing it for free, but you're not. You're not doing it for free.
Mm.
You're learning something that's going to make you loads of money if you're serious.
Mm.
And if you are that serious, why do you need to be paid? And they look at me, and that's because it's the, you know, some people have an end user mentality, right? And
they have a what, sorry?
An end user mentality, meaning that they don't really think about the bigger picture.
Yeah, they want quickly, smash and grab. Yeah.
But there's not... Me as an example, there's nothing smash and grab about it. This is a long journey over years, building assets, finding ways to multiply and compound my assets. Mm. This wasn't done overnight, you know. So that is how you do it. You have to be serious. You have to think about the bigger picture. You go without now so you can be really full in the future.
Mm.
And again, it's cliche, but it's the truth.
And you've managed to have both experience. You've managed to have like the creative industry, but shooting in the corporate world as well.
Yes.
And you even said oftentimes on like low budget film sets, you see that people are a bit less serious. Like they're on their Snapchat.
On the phone. I can't stand it. When I'm on set and like you've got, I mean, it doesn't happen very often now, but you get crew filming the performance of the artist. Like, things like that. It's just unprofessional etiquette. And if you want people to take you seriously, you know, as they say in 48 Laws of Power, Robert Greene, protect your reputation and guard it with your life. And what he's basically saying is, you know, you need to be careful because people will close doors on you that you didn't even know were open. That often happens to black people, unfortunately. Just period. Just because we're black.
So why make it harder for yourself?
That's what I'm saying.
And that's the reality.
It's the truth.
And I loved it when you said that because, okay, we can complain or we can... And oftentimes it's not a complaint. It's definitely an issue that needs to be raised in terms of institutional racism. So, but we're here now.
We're here.
This is what we've gone through. So are you going to make it worse for yourself by acting the idiot? Mm-hmm. Or are you going to, like you said, conform, infiltrate... and learn something.
That's right. I believe, you know, albeit slightly controversial, but I believe that if you're born in England, you have a silver spoon in your mouth.
100%.
No matter what colour you are. And the only reason why I say that, I'm not saying it's, we know it's harder, facts. Mm-hmm. My mum said to me in primary school, I went to a all-white primary school, I think I was two black kids in the school. I went to school in Eltham, right? Southeast London.
Quite racist.
Tremendously racist, right? And, and my mum said to me, Antoine, you need to be better than your white friends. You need to work harder. If you have qualifications, the same qualifications as a white dude, and you go into an interview, you may not get that job because of the colour of your skin. And again, I'm being careful of my words. You may not get that job, right? You may, but you may not get that job unless you are better. And then your skills are undeniable. So you always have to strive. That stuck with me. And that's why I've always been so savage driven, because I understood what that meant at a very, very young age, that you have to be better. You know, as they say, aim for the stars to reach the sky. You have to be better. You have to be better.
And that's with everything, the way you present yourself, your reputation, the way you speak.
Yeah.
And it's important.
Very important.
So if you...
It's your brand.
Yeah, exactly.
It's your brand.
Yeah. So if you, let's say, if I scrapped all your success right now in the bin, bam, gone, what industry right now would you go into?
Did you take my money as well?
Yeah, fuck it, why not? Okay, I'll leave you with 5K.
Crypto, I'm joking.
Why are you joking? What, you're not a lover of crypto?
I have a healthy portfolio.
A healthy?
Yeah.
Oh, what are we saying? What's healthy?
Healthy.
Yeah?
Yeah.
More than a million?
Healthy.
Okay, fair enough. But you also have the low risk of property, which I love. But
yeah, exactly.
Okay, so I've taken everything away from you. 5 million.
Okay, do you know what I'll do? Do you know what I'll do? I'll do it all again. I would go and get a full-time job. I'll work in the film industry and filmmake and save my filmmaking money and let my full-time job pay my life. And I would use the film money as asset generating to build and do it all over again. That's exactly what I would do.
Yeah, because you're a strong believer in having two jobs. If you're starting out...
It's hard, you lose sleep, you don't socialize as much.
Yeah.
But you don't, if it was easy and if you only had to just do small steps to get big, reward, we would all have it.
We know
this.
Yeah.
So we shouldn't pretend.
So one job for your bills.
Listen, you have to make sacrifices. People don't understand. A lot of people like myself that are self-made, we have made painful sacrifices. It could be sleep. It could be relationships. It could be you're not socializing. Your friends think you're selfish. But you're not. It's just what it takes for you to get to where you want to get to. Then, I mean, I'm in a position now where I help a lot of people now around me because I'm selfish and and got to where I got to by being hyper-focused. Mm-hmm. So this is what it takes, or we'd all have it. Some people are built for it, some people are not. But everybody's capable. Mm. And that's what I want to get across. Everybody's capable.
And you waited as well. You could have used your profit money to buy the Lambo, the Bentley, but you actually waited.
Absolutely.
Yeah, and I respect that. Because it's hard. Like right now, I was even saying, like on Instagram, it's very hard to break away from, if you've got a bit of money, you want to spend it on like drip, you want to spend it on watchable watches, appreciate a lot of them, but do you get what I mean?
Yeah,
and
absolutely.
For you to actually hold back.
And social media doesn't help because it creates more peer pressure. It creates people thinking that they need to have a certain representation or persona to be validated. Mm. So some of that might be material. Mm-hmm. Are you with me? So that can make people also feel like, I need to do something now so I can look good when they're not being patient and disciplined. Mm-hmm. You need discipline. It's one of those characteristics that you need to be really successful. Discipline is super important.
Mm. And going back to what I was saying, so you would definitely advise to have the one income to pay your bills and then another income to save capital, to buy assets or to invest in whatever business you
want
to.
That's the
two jobs.
That's the formula. Obviously, with a lens manufacturing company, it hit big. So I'm taking huge amount of money every year and I'm reinvesting it into my property firm and I'm buying property all over the place, like literally like Monopoly. But again, I'm not buying property that is worth the value that it's worth. I'm buying distressed property. Property is on auction. I'm developing property.
Like so you're a developer as well now?
Oh, yeah, for sure. Yeah. For the last 4 years.
Okay.
Well, that's also been able to multiply. So I'm not just always getting new money. Mm-hmm. I'm then remortgaging property because I've added maybe 100 racks or 150 or whatever on it, remortgage that, put that money and then buy that property. And that's when it's just gone quick because I understand leverage.
What do you think about interest-only properties?
What about it?
Do you think it's a good thing to do in terms of to build a portfolio?
Of course.
Yeah?
Will you get more cash flow, so more passive income. Mm-hmm. The capital growth is the capital growth. Mm-hmm. You don't get more capital growth or less capital growth because you've got a repayment mortgage or you've got interest only. The capital growth is the capital growth. Mm-hmm. But all it means is you make more money by having an interest only mortgage because you have less expenditure.
Yeah, of course.
So you have more money to spend or you have more money to reinvest into more assets.
Mm.
It makes sense. You don't become rich by owning your house outright. Mm-hmm. You become rich by owning 10 houses.
100%. So again, what's next in terms of away from film and property? Because you, like I said, you're still young. Like you must see something else that piques your interest.
I'm not sure right now. The same way I wasn't sure at 21 what I wanted to be and what I wanted to do, I knew I wanted to be successful. Right? That's all I knew, right? Right now, I would say to you all these years later, being where I'm at in an elevated position, all I know is I want to give back.
Okay.
That's all I know.
You've lined it up nicely for me and I'm going to be a bit cheeky now.
Go on.
Yeah. Every single person I've spoken to so far,
yeah.
I've asked them to take on one person to shadow. And I know you said that your DMs are full, but forget your DMs. This is about me now.
Okay.
Someone who comes through me, are you willing to allow them to shadow you for a few weeks?
Yes.
Yeah?
Yes, I
am. I will do the vetting. I'm happy to do that.
Okay.
Take the admin away from you.
Okay.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Deal?
Yeah.
Good.
Done.
Thanks for coming.
Pleasure.